not gangster. That's very not gangster.
I came up, got my name up. So when they speak of who blinged up, I'm who they bring up. Come up dissing and you'll come up missing. I'm a cutthroat baller like O.J. Simpson. I came up, got my name up. So when they speak of who blinged up, I'm who they bring up. Come up dissing and you'll come up missing.
Say that again. I couldn't hear you over the sound of me shitting myself.
I came up, got my name up. So when they speak of who blinged up, I'm who they bring up. Come up dissing and you'll come up missing. I'm a cutthroat baller like O.J. Simpson. Little homie, listen, try and serve me. I put a 25 in your back like Barry Bonds jersey. You on the streets or on the beach, y'all ain't able. Cause two, I shit on rappers like major labels. What's with the ice grilling, homie? Change your face. This heat will do more to tan you, to change your race. Girls love metaphor, and I love them back. Addicted to getting head, chicks call me the brainiac. Battle rap with words, wall like Jihad. I write dope, flow crack, my notepad need rehab. Fuck y'all CDs, y'all can't see these or touch these. Rhyme so chronic, my soul's give you the munchies.
But you know what though? Like, I was sitting here yesterday and I was minding my business. I was listening to music and the edibles had kicked in. And when they kick in, it starts to make you think about stuff that you probably wouldn't think about.
Like
so
what?
I was listening to music. And, like, music makes you just think about, like, when you're high, you listen to music, it makes you think about lyrics more than you probably should.
Okay.
So I was on my old school kick. I was listening to like a bunch of random old R&B songs. And then since we're on music, we're gonna jump to the next topic about Mr. R. Kelly pretty soon. But you remember the group Black, right?
Of course.
And they had the
girls,
had the
right?
Song Boom. Yeah, right. And they had the song Boom Like an 808.
Yeah.
And as I'm listening to like the chorus of the song, it hits me. At 29 years old, I'm like, this song is about riding dick. It's gotta be. This song is about riding penis. It's gotta be, Sam. Boom like an 808. Circles like a figure eight. Like, and this is what it's about. This has gotta be.
I'm mad at you for just now catching on to that. And it's, you need to be under the influence for it to even click. Second, that is the beauty of old music. Like, old music didn't come out and just tell you what they were talking about. They masked it behind good melodies, catchy words, and verbiage play. Okay? You didn't always know what they were talking about, but you just knew it wasn't what you thought. Okay? Music, this day and age, they just come out and just tell you right away, like, I ain't got time to play. I'm trying to eat your pussy. And that literally would be the lyric. That would be the actual lyric. So there's no subtlety in music no more. But yeah, music back in the day, especially in the 90s, dog, it definitely was mag. Like, let's talk about lyrics from that one guy who pees on people, Mr. R. Kelly. Like, if you actually go back and look at some of his tracks, his first couple of singles was Honey Love. Like, first of all, what is Honey Love? What would you think Honey Love is?
Well, as a child, I assume R. Kelly wanted some honey for his waffle. As an adult, he was clearly saying, "Hey, you should give me some of that drip drip, some of that."
That's basically what it was. No, young R. Kelly.
He was a young love. R. Kelly wanted some of that young.
So he was basically he was telling us at a very early age that he was definitely into young women.
Yeah,
if he's asking for honey love.
All your favorite R. Kelly songs talk about child molestation. That's terrible.
You know what? Don't do that to me, bro. Because sometimes I do listen to some. Well, I don't listen to it no more. But you don't want to mess up listen to when you think he's talking about young women. Like, he does have a nasty track record.
Let me see ID before I get me beat. Come on, bro. He didn't want to see your ID. He didn't care what
he wanted. He just wanted to make sure you were underage.
Right. Oh, you legal? You gotta go, man. You gotta go. All these legalities and shit. You gotta go.
But when you look at
I was listening to a little bit of Samaya, and you know, literally, my love is like, whoa, fam. She just out the gate told everybody, like, look, I got the best box in the game. Nobody got hands on me, fam. It is what it is. I'm Michael Jordan of the sex right now. I was like, oh my God, Maya just got the best box out of it. This is what you think about stuff.
I mean, maybe she do. I mean, think about it, dog. When you go back to R.Kelly, he did have some titles that now you have to go back and really look at, like, what was he really talking about? Because, like, you seem like you ready. Like, you remind me of something.
No way.
Step into my room. Down low, nobody has to know. Like, when you really go back and you look at
That's why Mr. Biggs beat him up. Oh, girl, underage. You sleeping with Mr. Biggs' daughter.
So that's what it was. Wasn't his wife, it was his daughter?
It was his daughter. So that's the story they won't tell you. And everybody wants you to think that R. Kelly was knocking Mr. Biggs' wife. He was really sleeping with his daughter. Because, I mean, look at the video, fam. Who gets beat up and left in the middle of the desert over a wife? I mean, sure, you love your wife, but you don't love your wife, but you love your kids.
I mean, since we're talking about Robert, I mean, but some of his music was the shit. Like, Robert. It just sounds like a rapey name. I'm sorry. he has some hits that was not always, you know, about that. Like, when a woman's fed up, like, for a long time, and still even to this day, old black single women, that was they anthem. That's the song they turn on when the relationship was over.
Okay.
And they finally.
Here's where I throw a monkey wrench in your plan. So is the woman really fed up, or did she grow up and is now an adult and realize that she's been on some rapey shit the entire time I've known you, fam, and I'm not standing for it anymore?
You might be right there. Okay, what about Fiesta? Fiesta was a party.
Yeah. What about Fiesta? They don't know who's invited to the party.
It's a Fiesta, so it's probably Hispanic people.
Got Friday on the DVD. Come on, man. Ain't no grown woman watching Friday like that. That was a movie for us.
I mean, he had a song called Feeling on Your Booty. I wish.
Booty of
I don't know. This was like, I don't know about that. Feeling on your booty. Feeling on your booty. I'm mad he used to get that high note for that. Okay, what about the tracks with him and Jay-Z when they did the Best of Both World albums?
Maybe that's why R. Kelly got pepper spray.
You might be right, dog, because he had a song called Take You Home With Me. Green Light. Somebody's
maybe,
girl.
Maybe
Shorty.
Maybe by the time it was... Maybe by the time it was time to be the second version of the Best of Birth. Maybe by the time the second Best of Both Worlds album came out of there, if you have realized that R. Kelly is a freaky dude. And he wasn't a part of that, so he had his pepper spray.
Do you think that Jay-Z may have known about R. Kelly's nefarious ways and so I'm not fucking with you, bruh? And that's why the tour ended.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure he brought like seven teenagers to the studio, and Holmes was like, "Yo, what's this thing?" And he's like, "Hey, get out of here."
It's like, you got to go, bro. So what you're trying to say is, Jay tried to throw the girls out because they was definitely too young. He didn't want them back there with him and his entourage. R. Kelly was like, "Hold up, bruh," and they got into it during the fight because he didn't want to shoot. somebody got pepper sprayed. So one of the little young girls, because she didn't have a gun, took the pepper spray out the purse, spraying everybody because she didn't like to be, she didn't know what to do, and Kales caught it.
Facts. R.Kelly was pepper sprayed during the studio session. That sounds like a plausible story.
Only women carry pepper spray. That, you know what? That is a true statement. Only women and security guards carry pepper spray. And I don't think no security guard felt threatened enough to take out pepper spray. So he probably did get sprayed by a woman.
Right.
But speaking of this,
underage woman at that.
All right. So for those of you who may be listening and be like, y'all going hard on R. Kelly right now, what has he done to justify the current hate? Because if you don't know, people, right now, currently, there is a Mute R. Kelly movement going on where people are basically demanding major stop the play of R. Kelly's music, the sale of R. Kelly's music. Spotify, being one of the companies who is also backing this movement, has recently removed all of R. Kelly's music off of Spotify. But a lot of people are like, well, what has he done besides the peace situation that has justified this outcry? Yes, people, Bill Cosby has recently just been found guilty. He has not been sentenced as of yet. It'll be a while before we actually hear that information, because there's appeals and everything that can be done in regard to it. But with R. Kelly, he has came up a lot because a lot of people are saying, why has nobody ever came after this man? And he constantly keeps doing stuff. So here's a track record of a few things in R. Kelly's history that justifies the current movement that's going on in regards to him. First things first, if you did not listen to music in the 90s, you don't know nothing about music in the 90s, you just happened to be born in the 90s, there was a young lady who came out named Aaliyah. She is the blueprint to almost every single R&B singer you have out right now, even Beyonce. Even in the movie, the terrible movie, but it was still in the movie, where her and R. Kelly got married. The thing about it was at the time R. Kelly was 27 years old and Aaliyah was only 15. Due to the fact that Aaliyah is not alive and she was actually forced to annul the marriage. To this day, I still don't know why she even did it. I think dude coerced her and basically said, I can help your career. And she married him as some pack. Okay.
First of all, here's my question. Now, in order to get married, you either have to be in front of a preacher, who is a man of God, or a judge in a courthouse. So who let this go on is my question.
Well, think about it is, bro, depending on what state you're in, some states do allow you to get married at that young of an age because of cultural reasons. Like some cultures, like Hispanic cultures, for an example, a kid is considered an adult when they're 15 because they have this quinceañera for the women and the boys have some kind of like little ceremony or whatnot. But once you have that 15-year-old ceremony, you're an adult. Whereas in Americans, we do it at 18. Once you turn 18, you get all these rights and you get to do all these things. Hispanic communities, especially Mexicans, for an example, they do it at 15. So if you go to a Hispanic-heavy area, the priest might not be against marrying off a 15-year-old. Normal. Actually, a lot of cultures, marrying off the young is normal. It's only America who's gone ahead and minimized it, that being married at that young of an age is considered a bad thing. Okay? So, it is, let's be honest, to us, it is. It's horrible. Like, what could a little 15-year-old do for you, period? Especially when I think about how girls used to look when I was 15. Yeah, some of them had developed a lot faster than others, but at the end of the day, what could she possibly do for you? All right? But this wasn't the first one dealing with 15-year-olds.
When I got to ninth grade, it was like a whole new world.
It's true, but not to the point where a 27-year-old should want you. Like, that's what I'm getting.
Yeah, true.
All right. So in December of 1996, Kelly actually got sued by an aspiring singer named Tiffany Hawkins, who allegated that he engaged in inappropriate sexual conduct. The thing about it was, Tiffany was only 15 at the time, and R. Kelly was 24 when this happened. So this actually even happened before he even knew Aaliyah. Okay? So this was 3 years before the so-called Aaliyah marriage ever occurred. The thing about it was everybody spread the rumors that the allegations was false. And R. Kelly turned around and countersued her for defamation of character. Then, at first, it was still denied, but he later settled the initial lawsuit for an undisclosed amount of money. Now, I don't know about you, bro. All right? But when somebody goes behind closed doors and says, hey, here's the money, shut up. Yeah, I feel like you're guilty. Right? You're guilty.
You are guilty.
Okay? Going back to the Bill Cosby case, the one person who was able to find Bill guilty, this was something from their past that came up, that Bill did pay this girl off at one point in time. This is why we said that this was her sugar baby, though. But because money was exchanged for activities or silence, that's why they were able to find Bill Cosby guilty. And in this situation, because she took the money to shut up, the lawsuit was dropped. Okay? But you know, me and you, something like that's considered guilty. Now, unfortunately, luckily, a particular reporter named Jim Derogus, DeRogus, was investigating R. Kelly from the Aaliyah situation and then the Tiffany situation. He never stopped the investigation. Luckily, because of him, this investigation led to the sex tape that eventually leaked about R. Kelly engaging in activities with the young woman, the young 14-year-old girl, and being peed on. This actually led to R. Kelly and the indictment on multiple charges for child pornography charges, which we later come to find out he was found not guilty. Okay? Some people said that because his money was long and video footage was bad back then, it's the only reason why he got off. Okay? In 2002, oh, let me go back. 2000, another young lady named Tracy Sampson actually sued R. Kelly for allegedly having sex with her when she was 17. Okay? R. Kelly basically talked her into giving him oral sex. She did not want to. He was often treated as his personal sex object. And when he did what he did, he would cast her to the side. He would call her to come to the studios to go ahead and engage in sexual activities. He often tried to control every aspect of her life, basically being very controlling. Ironically, like the first case, it was also settled out of court, and they reached an undisclosed deal. Once again, money was paid. People were held quiet. All right? Now, in 2002... a young lady named Patrice Jones sued him as well. Lady was 16 years old. Okay? This was actually reported by... Well, because what happens is R. Kelly gets these young girls, and he sells them a dream. Now, you got to remember, dog, R. Kelly was the king of R&B, dog. And this was during, like, late 2000. So what albums were he dropping during this time? This was during a time when things like Chocolate Factory, The Best of Both Worlds, TP2. Like, these were his big... TP2 was the big album out during this time, and he was working on the Best of Both World tour. So all this right here was during that time frame. And during that time frame, Kelly was writing for a lot of people too. So he was the dude. So if R. Kelly says, hey, I can put you on, you're not going to argue with it, especially if you were a young teenager. Think about it. 17 years old, you in high school in the cafeteria eating chicken patties, being hit on by the fat kid who you can't stand, and somehow R. Kelly comes across you. Okay? And you've seen what he did for other, like Aaliyah's career. You see how his music is going. So you saying, fuck it, I want to work with dude. And that's how these girls are doing. They're finding that R. Kelly wants to work with them and wants to get them somewhere, and it turns into being his sex object. And in their mind, it's like, okay, maybe this is how the business goes. Maybe if I do this with him, I don't have to go and be a musician. I can just marry R. Kelly and get money that way. Or I can have his baby and get all that child support. Okay? This particular one, Patrice Jones, even though she first started messing around with R. Kelly at 16, he talked her into having an abortion. Because of that situation, of course, you know, if she had the kid, it would have got out. Kells would have been done. She sued him for the money to be quiet in so many words because they didn't say what she was suing him for. I'm thinking he was suing her because she wanted hush money, because after that happened, he threw her to the side. Basically, in so many words, once again, Kelly fighted it going to court. The singer eventually settled out of court for money. So once again, this is like the fourth girl who done settled out of court. 24, this is literally a month, bro, a month after the abortion one. A third lawsuit comes from Montina Woods, who is an exotic dancer who claimed Kelly's taped her during a sex session without his permission. This is probably the only person who then came up that's over 20. I mean, over 18. And she sued him because he recorded them, and apparently the second sex tape, which is the one that everybody's been talking about lately, that the police then had, was her. All right.
That's the one when he was eating ass in the barber chair?
No, that's still in the first one. This is supposed to be a more recent one for an older woman. All right? Because this was in, what, 2002? No, this might be the second scene on that same tape. That might be the second scene on the same tape, because I remember it was two different girls on the tape. So, yeah, this one might have been her. All right. Now, 2017 in July, this is what the most recent information is that everybody's been going on about. Basically, the same reporter who asked Kelly about the underage women 20 years ago basically got a recent break in another story. It was basically said that the singer was accused of running a sex cult and he was preying on young black women. Now, if you look at the previous three or four cases that we talked about a minute ago, the allegations were all younger women. The only one that was not was the stripper chick who got recorded without her permission. But the investigation focused on two women who were allegedly being helped by Kelly in his rental property, a 19-year-old chick from Georgia and an 18-year-old chick from Florida who was 17 at the time she met Robert, who he allegedly submits to emotional abuse. According to the reports, this includes dictating what they ate, how they dressed, when they bathed, when they slept, and how they engaged in sexual encounters that got recorded. So basically, he then took two chicks, put them up in a spot, and he controls their everyday lives. Okay? They didn't do nothing without his permission. In a later report, the women who were once in Kelly's inner circle described seeing the sex cult as witnesses of Stockholm Syndrome. If you don't know what Stockholm Syndrome, people, is, it's when you've been captive so long that you start to relate to your capturer. So it's like saying if Juan held the chicken in his house against her will, And over time,
my nigga, why gotta be me?
Because I got a wife and kids. I can't be holding people captive with wife and kids. You're single. I'm gonna use
most,
you.
Most weirdos who do shit like that have wife and kids. You
nope,
don't watch
they be
TV?
Single. They be nope. They be single because you don't know.
Nope.
You know what?
Nope,
you can't categorize. Only thing we can say that is constant in any of these crazy people is they're usually white. But cult leaders are usually white.
I watch way too much Law and Order SVU. He had a whole wife. He had a whole wife and kid with a 13-year-old in the basement. And the wife acted like she didn't know who was in the basement. And she was probably a victim, too. That's man.
Probably. All right. So in this particular case, Stockholm syndrome is when you start to relate to them. And this is what happened with these young ladies. They had got to the point where they had been doing it for so long, and so many lies are being told to them, and such a controlling situation at a young age. They basically start to believe that this is how things are supposed to be and this is normal. So when things start to hit the fan in regards to it, they actually came to his aid. All right. Now, another particular woman, Jahonda Pace, actually signed the non-disclosure agreement, but she went on ahead and violated that non-disclosure agreement and actually talked about having sex with Kelly while she was underage with the same reporter who's been doing all this investigation. All right. And this was in July of last year. Fast forward to October, another young lady named Kitty Jones actually comes out as well, too, detailing alleged physical and emotional abuse that she suffered while in a relationship with Kelly. Kelly starved her. He coerced her in sexual encounters with other women. He physically abused her, and he kept a constant monitoring on her. Now, the fact that she assumed that they were in a relationship with all of this going on definitely is a sign of Stockholm syndrome and a truly controlling individual. All right. Then, get this one. This last month. In a criminal complaint filed on April 9th, an anonymous woman and her lawyer told Dallas police that the accuser was victim of several forms of criminal misconduct by Kelly, included but not limited to unlawful restraint, furnishing alcohol and illegal drugs to a minor, and aggravated assault. The woman reportedly had a relationship with Kelly when she was 19 and when she was allegedly being trained to be in his cult. Okay. Have you mind that also a couple of people, including part of R. Kelly's legal team and his actual staff, has basically cut all ties with R. Kelly as well, too. So my thing about Mr. Robert is the people that have been around you all this time, why people just now looking at R. Kelly and saying something needs to be done about this dude? Like, how do we allow it to grow this far?
You asking me?
I'm asking you, bruh. Because Kelly's in his 50s, man.
Out here dressing like a superhero, too. Like, niggas wearing spandex outfits with baseball caps. Like, something wrong with that.
Like, because I'm sitting here looking.
They probably should have got R. Kelly out of here when he did an interview and confessed that the first woman he ever wanted to marry was his mama. So they should have hit that nigga with the straight jacket, padded rooms, threw away the kid. Because I'm looking at
an article that was done, and it was like his new accuser, which is the 19-year-old girl we were just talking about. The new accuser says she's 19 at the time the crimes were alleged to have occurred. Accusation of sexual-related crimes with teenagers are a reoccurring theme in the singer's life. An ex-girlfriend once said he was trained. Once said he trained a 14-year-old girl to be one of his sex slaves.
Yeah, dog. Like, I'm gonna get out of here.
Like, my whole thing is, what could you find sexually attractive about a minor? Like, you couldn't find... You couldn't find great qualities in a mom? Like, so, are you down with the Mute R. Kelly movement?
Hey, it's been a while since I've listened to any R. Kelly.
So, if R. Kelly came out and dropped a new CD tomorrow, and the CD is fire, okay? It's fire.
I'm not sure I want to listen to it. What seems like, so do I hold your actions that you commit privately against the art? You know, I mean, you know, R. Kelly is a bit of a pervert, and I use "bit" loosely because he's a major pervert. But his music is still fire. But it's like, do I really want to dig deep into, like, well, what was your inspiration behind how you put this great project out? Because I don't think I want to know. It's kind of like how Popeye's chicken is delicious, but if I was to work at Popeye's chicken, I probably wouldn't want to eat it.
I would have to go with... The best example is the Frank Ocean song, where he... What song was it? I can't think of the name of it. Where he... Yeah, it was like the song was phenomenal. It was a missing you song, and it was definitely an open love letter. But then you go and find out the open love letter was about one gay moment he had.
Yeah, thinking about you. Yeah, it's still a great song.
Yeah, that's what it was. Thinking about you. I couldn't think about it.
I know the meaning of this great song.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. It's like, the song is great. It's definitely a song that if you want to sample lyrics from it, to send it as a text message to a girl you talking to and you ain't said nothing, you haven't seen her in a couple of days, it's definitely a great source to pull from.
Right,
but
it's great source material.
Yeah, it's great source material, but then you have to sit back and say to yourself, but this was written for a homosexual. So you can't listen to the song without picturing Frank Ocean laying on the bed with a thought bubble of some gay guy oiling himself up in his head. Pause. like you can't take it serious now. You can't. It taints the music, and that's kind of how I feel about like the R. Kelly situation.
But
Tinashe, I don't care about dudes, but he's getting muted too.
Okay, I feel like you can't use Frank Ocean as an example.
Why not? That's exactly what it is.
Because we're not homophobic, so we don't care.
We're not homophobic. But we know that it affects the music. I don't care what you say; it affects the music.
But I feel like if that song came on in the radio and you was in the car driving, you still might sing it.
I'm not singing it. I'm gonna look around and see who in the car with me and look and see how they react.
You're singing it because you know in the context of you singing it, you may be talking about you should be talking about your wife. I was gonna say you may be talking about your wife like you wouldn't be thinking about your wife. I don't really know what you think about.
Right.
You're gonna think about rabbits and monkeys.
Not,
I'm sorry.
I mean, sometimes, but not for that reason. Okay, so then that was using that same example. So that means that when "Feeling on the Booty" come on and you in the car with your girlfriend, you gonna lean over and sing the high parts of "Feeling on Your Booty" to your girl, but you know in the back of your mind that Kels is probably rubbing on a 14-year-old chick to make it the song.
He was rubbing teenage booty.
Right. So because he was rubbing on teenage booty, you're going to tell me that you can honestly sit there and continue to listen to that song without having the chills coming up your spine. Like, okay. still gonna have fun with your girl. You're gonna be like, ugh, I hate you, man.
Yeah, bro, bro, boss creepy. And I don't know what XXXTentacion has done. I don't look to review it, but with a name like XXXTentacion, we should probably get that nigga out of here too. He probably whack. All
right, so the reason why he has been put on the chopping block, especially for Spotify, is in 2006 he has multiple felony charges for domestic violence, including aggravated battery, woman, domestic battery by strangulation, false imprisonment, and witness tampering. Bro, that's...
My nigga is...
So basically, bro done went out here, then got somebody pregnant. Okay? Then got somebody pregnant, beating on her, tried to choke her out. It was his ex-girlfriend. That's what I thought it was. All right. Okay. So nearly one year after the Florida rapper allegedly assaulted his pregnant girlfriend, the woman's 2.5-hour testimony, which she gave in January, details a series of disturbing physical encounters with the rapper. The two reportedly met online. Number one, and later linked at a movie theater. From there, X invited her to a party and expressed his interest in the woman. He quickly suggests they move in together. Mistake number two. Roughly 2 weeks after moving in with X, she claims the alleged physical abuse began. After she complimented a male friend on his jewelry, X slapped her and broke her iPhone. The same day, he approached the woman with barbecue sauce pitchfork and a barbecue sauce cleaner and asked that she choose between the two because he was going to insert one of them in her vagina. She was never penetrated by either one of them, though. But the fact he came up there and asked her. The woman also claimed that while they were living together in Orlando, Florida, X threatened to kill her almost every day. One of the most disturbing acts of violence happened after X reportedly heard the victim humming along to a featured artist on one of his songs. As a result, he headbutted her, punched her, on her, put her in the bathtub where he continued to physically abuse the woman to cut out her tongue because I was singing the song. In August of 2016, X was arrested in a separate case. During the time, the woman moved in with some of X's friends and ended up having sex with another man. Okay? A month later, X was released and they got back together. The woman later found out she was pregnant with X's child, which they reportedly planned. But while confronting her about the person she had cheated on him with, X threatened to kill her and her unborn child. "You need to tell me the truth right now or I'll kill you and this jit," X reportedly told the woman after his phone call. Jit was in reference to the unborn baby. After taking away her phone, he kept her in the bedroom for days, unable to escape. Ultimately, she was able to break free and get help from an ex-boyfriend's mother who drove the woman to the hospital. X is charged with aggravated battery of a pregnant woman, domestic battery of strangulation, false imprisonment, and witness tampering. If convicted, he could face significant amount of prison time, and apparently he went to court on October 5th. So, yeah, this boy didn't have it all upstairs anyway. Like, dog needs to be assassinated. Like, this is a time when you feel like capital punishment needs to come back because it would be definitely justified on its own. Like, bro. Okay, so. No one deserves physical abuse from anybody for any reason. And the fact that she was getting abused because basically dog was in his feelings. Something was wrong with dude to begin with. I mean, number one, apparently he does not know how to have a relationship because a lot of that shit never have happened. Number two, I don't know what was wrong with her to begin with because, first of all, you met him online. There, you met him when you seen he was an up-and-coming popular rapper, or you must have had some issues going on at home and he seemed like a way out. Because after only thing you did was go to the movies one time with dude, you opted to move in with him.
Must have showed like, the goods in the parking lot.
Like, something right there isn't right to begin with. But taking consideration, the younger generation doesn't know anything about love anymore. They do everything for money and status. So the fact that he looked like he had money, and you fell in love with the fact that he had money coming in, you thought you made a come up. I give you that. People used to do that back in the day. These old school R&B singers in the 50s and the 60s, they come rolling through your town. You think that's the hottest thing out right now. Dog wants to shack up with you for a minute. You do it. You think you're about to make the lick. I'm not mad at you. Let a popular singer woman come at me in my younger days talking about let's go on the road together. I probably would have did it. I told my mom in the heartbeat, like, hey, I got this new woman. We in love. We about to hit the road. I'll talk to y'all later. Like, I'm not going to lie. I'll talk to y'all later. But the minute when you realize things wasn't right, like, he hit her not even, like, 2 weeks after moving in. Like, bro, what would she say? She said that somebody's necklace was fly, and he slapped you. At that moment, that's the sign to get the fuck out. And he broke your phone, and all you said was somebody had a phone. Then that he came to you the same day with a barbecue pitchfork and a barbecue sauce cleaner. Bro, that's the little brush you clean off the grill with. You didn't think that, you know what, this might not be the life for me.
Somebody gotta get this nigga out of here, bro.
Like, that nigga's got to go. And Spotify has also banned his music from theirs as well too. Now, you can't search the music, but it does still come up in the playlist, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, so if you get the This Is section, curated one, you'll get that. But if you were to go to the Rap Cavalier, so the ones where Spotify features up-and-coming artists is, that nigga is gone. He's not in there whatsoever. My question is will other venues such as like SoundCloud, who elevated his popularity because he was a SoundCloud rapper in the beginning, will they still keep him as featured artists or music on there? And like, I don't know, bro. Like, what is wrong with this generation, bro? Why would you want to put a pitchfork in your chick? And that's supposed to be
all that maybe he called
her sexual thing. He didn't. That was the problem. She didn't do nothing yet. Now, don't get me wrong, after he got locked, he did go smashing up things. But after your man threatened to put a pitchfork in you, I would go look for somebody else too. I would take the time to
chick threatened me with a pitchfork, I'm not coming home.
True. You shouldn't.
It's game all the way over, fam.
Yeah. That nigga got. Light so, it. Here at Tonedefradio, we have come to the master conclusion that nigga gotta die.
These niggas is crazy, bro. Like, you know, women are crazy too for putting up with this shit. Like, man, y'all gotta relax.
I think they just buy into the promise of what could be next. All right. Now, unfortunately, this is not the last bad story that we have today. Apparently, Young Lo. Now, I don't know who this is. This is one of these new rappers. basically has recently been accused of a rape involvement with a young lady. And the sad part is, it happened at a Chris Brown party. I really hate that, because Chris is trying to get his life together, and he out here just trying to do what's right, and he keeps getting drug and shit.
Well,
like,
I
pretty
heard
soon,
that
Chris
had nothing to. I heard he had nothing to do with it.
He didn't, but it was the fact that it happened at his house. It happened at his house. All right, so on to lighter news. Are you a fan of Will Smith?
I get jiggy with Will. Will's cool.
Okay. Are you also a fan of Martin Lawrence?
I can get jiggy with Martin.
Okay. So, what is one thing that these two guys have in common?
Bad Boys.
What if I told you that it's official that there will be a Bad Boys 3?
About time.
So, it has been official. Sony has gone ahead and actually announced the release date for the third movie, Bad Boys 3, a.k.a. Bad Boys for Life. Is not going to be anytime soon, of course, because of the busy schedule of both Will and Martin, as well as production. The movie will not be released until January 17, 2020. Now, technically, that's not too far away, being the fact that we're already halfway done with 2018, and we got enough Thanos stuff to hold us over in 2019, and we'll be okay
waiting
a few
more.
We can
wait on that.
We can wait on it. So, yeah. So the plot summary for the upcoming movie is: the film, we see Lawrence's character, Marcus, working as a private eye after a fallout with Smith. Mike, who is going through a midlife crisis as a bachelor, who finally wants to mature all while dealing with a new, young, cocky partner who is loyal to Mike, but that loyalty is not reciprocated. Fine bonds with Ned when he returns to the fray. So basically, in so many words, Martin's character is off doing his own thing now. He's tired of Will Smith shit. He doesn't want to work with dude anymore. He's too wild. But now Martin has hit that age where most men, when you're out here sowing your wild oats and you basically have sowed enough and you want to settle down, and now you see somebody under you basically being you. Everything that Will Smith went through when he was with Martin, he's now going through with this new young cat, and he needs help. So that's where we are. To me,
that
I feel like
no sense.
It does. It's the growing up part. So
no,
when you were
the
young,
only reason why it the only reason why it doesn't make sense is because in Bad Boys 2, what you just read is what they were going through, but they fixed it. They fixed everything. Like, he didn't want to be his partner no more. He filed for the papers. And then they got back together, and then they went to go save their sister at the end of the movie. And then everything was cool.
Well,
so where in that time are you going to tell me that they weren't getting along and make me believe it? See, no.
Well, we might see it. We might see it. No, you're still going to go see it, so stop lying to yourself. For all we know, you know what? Stuff still happens. How many times have couples gotten together and tried to fix their marriage and stayed together only to still get a divorce? Because that's how you have to look at it. Martin and Will's character was basically a couple. They were partners. Everything they did it as if they were a couple. Okay? So just like any relationship, sometimes you hit that point in your relationship where it's best to be apart to still be good. And that's what happens. They're friends. They couldn't be partners no more. Of life, Will's character was always a little bit wild. You can't say he wasn't. Okay? So Martin was like, dog, I'm a family man now. You're still a bachelor. that doesn't mesh. It doesn't work all the time. This is like me and you. The only difference is that you're not an outgoing party person. You don't have to go out kicking it all the time. So if you were always going out kicking it and me and you are always together, eventually I'm going to be like, bro, you need to sit the hell down. And you're going to eventually be like, why? I have no responsibilities. And that's going to pose a problem in our friendship. That's basically what happened in this so-called backstory. Their friendship was in jeopardy. So to save the friendship, they couldn't be partners no more. Plus, remember, Will was dating Martin's sister. So that could have been a conflict of interest, and they probably couldn't be partners no more after that either. It just didn't work. So I don't see the problem with it. It's the typical. It's like saying now Noah is starting to grow up, and Noah is doing things that you used to do. So you might be like, dog, you stupid, don't do that. And Noah looking at you like, shut up, you don't know what you're talking about. In actuality, you know exactly what you're talking about.
As long as he ain't taking his shirt off on purpose, says I'm okay.
Sadly, we live in a generation that he might actually do that. And it's okay.
No, it's not okay.
No. It's not okay in our eyes, because it's not okay. But the people around him was like, yeah, that's what you're supposed to do. Donald Glover's out here taking shirts off, shooting people like in a woman's stance.
If a nigga
and gunning down a whole
you like that, bro. Like,
bro, you better just die. You just better die.
Nah, bro, I'm coming back. I'm an angry guy. Like, hey, bro, I gotta come back. Ain't no nigga shooting me like this, bro. Yeah, he was standing like Michael Jackson, a smooth criminal.
A smooth criminal.
You should not be allowed to shoot people like this. So, in other news, I have recently, I have a DirecTV app on my phone now, where I can watch TV from my phone, watch my DVR, all that good groovy shit.
Do you have to be connected to your internet to do this?
No, I can do it. It's like data free TV. I can do it when I'm at work and all type of shit.
Oh shit! Let me get that login.
You don't even have direct TV.
I don't need to. I just need your login.
That's true.
I'll let you get up on my HBO Go.
Anyway, you deleted me from my story. You're trying to compromise my intelligence.
Continue.
Have you watched the full season of Atlanta?
I have not watched all of this season. I think I stopped. I stopped right after the barbershop episode.
That episode was funny as shit.
Dog, I was like, so pissed for him. I was so mad for him. And then the fact that the barber had the audacity to get mad when he was in somebody else's chair. But then the realest thing about that episode was Paperboy had to kind of like retail barber to cut his hair, which is something we always tend to forget about.
His personal struggle. Not one to get another barber, but life goes on, my guy.
It does. All right,
yeah,
continue
so
on with your story.
They got this. I don't know if this nigga was supposed to be Michael Jackson. But
all
like,
the episode with the brothers.
That episode was so weird.
The piano one. Yeah, it was a very controversial episode that people were talking about because. Okay, so. This season of Atlanta has the subtitle Robin Season. Okay? So every episode has a Robin theme in regards to it. All right? Like the barbershop one was being robbed of your time. Okay? Earn had a lot of stuff to do. The barber was basically playing around because he had already messed up his head. He couldn't, he had to get it fixed. Okay. So the whole thing was robbing for time. That episode with the two brothers was about robbing you for your childhood. Throughout the whole entire episode, you kind of thought that the pale dude, which was played by Donald Glover, if you didn't know, was was supposed to insinuate a guy who lost his childhood. Now, you're thinking the whole entire time, yeah, it's very Michael Jackson-ish when you think about Michael Jackson's childhood to the point that he was a grown man trying to live his second childhood. But you find out in the end that the brother really did exist. And the other brother was the caregiver. What the theme was in regards to that was the brother got robbed of his childhood because he became responsible for taking care of his famous brother instead. So everybody got robbed of their childhood, and the brother who was confined to a wheelchair got robbed of his freedom.
Okay,
yeah,
wait. So the guy Donald Glover played, that was the guy who was robbed of his childhood because he ended up being a caregiver, correct?
Right. Correct.
So who was the nigga in the basement? Was the nigga in the basement the famous brother?
The famous brother.
That was the dude in the basement.
Right. He eventually ended up contracting something where he had to be the caregiver. But at that point in time, the caregiver took advantage and was like being the brother. So it's like saying, I'm your caregiver, but I hide you from the rest of the world and take credit for everything you do. So that's what happened. He wanted his freedom. He killed him. Yeah, it was all bad. It was the fact that all Aaron wanted was a piano, and he couldn't even get his piano, dog.
That episode was boss creepy. Hey, he was like, it's a shotgun in the attic. He was like, no, I can't try to go in the attic. I'm trying to get out of here.
Facts.
Yeah, so.
It wasn't there. What is the friend's name? I always forget his name.
I'm talking Darius.
Darius. All Darius be wanting. Darius is probably the smartest dude on that show, and don't nobody give him credit.
Yeah, he definitely is very special. That's because all potheads is woke, man. Smoke weed, you get woke. You wake up.
Didn't he take the Make America Great Again hat and turn it to You Mad?
He did.
Pissed off the white people. Well, all right. So, with that being
said, white people are easy to piss off.
No, they're not easy to piss off. They're easy to make awkward. They get awkward. Like, when you put them in situations where they don't know how to respond, very awkward. All right, so we have come to the end of the show. We've gone over a little bit on time. Oh, because we really talked about the Thanos situation a lot longer than I expected. But, that's because it was supposed to have been done 2 episodes ago. All right, so definitely make sure you guys tune in tomorrow. Check out. We actually have 2 shows being recorded tomorrow. Make sure you check out Love, Meditation, and Inspiration. It's Miami B's new show. She's actually stepping away from Undressed for a while and being on her grown woman stuff. And also tomorrow night will be the debut of the Urban Retcon Squad with me, Darren, and Travis. Yeah, bruh. Retcon. As we go ahead and we dive into comic books, movies, and video games, this particular week we're diving in a comic that all three of us called the New Teen Titans. Specifically, we're covering the origin of Tara. If you don't know who Tara is, check out the Judas Contract. She's literally been a key character on almost every alliteration of the Teen Titans. The cartoons, Teen Titans Go, the comics, the movies. So we're going to go ahead and dive a little bit in regard to that storyline. And also, we're going to have our epic battle. Something new here on Tonedefradio. Juan, I'll ask you first. This week's edition of Epic Battles, we are actually having... Who was it? The Winter Soldier versus Destro. Who do you think will win?
Destro.
All right. So we'll go ahead and talk about that. Juan has cast his vote for Destro. With that being said, people, we are going to go ahead and close night show the only way we know how.
Go to the end.